From its countries of origin. Welcome especially to those relatives of Sangharakshita, Dennis Lingwood, and also to those of you from other Buddhist Sanghas. Welcome. So So on this platform sit three people, all long-standing friends of Bante Sangharakshita. So we have, they've all known Bante for a long time. So we have Parami, International Order Convener, Mahamati, also a previous Order Convener, and Paramartha, who's been one of Bante's companions for 30 years, and who's been a particularly close friend for the whole of that time. So we're gathered here at Adhisthana, and Adhisthana is a very special place in the heart and the vision of Bante. He once told me that there had been three moments in his life when he felt an imperative to make a journey, where he felt very strongly he had to go somewhere. So the first was in India, when he made the journey from Bombay to Nagpur. And an hour after his arrival, the news came of the death of Dr. Ambedkar. Bante immediately took the platform and gave hundreds of speeches to the many, many disciples and followers of Dr. Ambedkar at that moment. And in doing so, he forged a relationship with India and with those disciples of Dr. Ambedkar. The next occasion was a moment in London where he suddenly felt he had to go visit his mother in East Anglia. And Paramartha drove him there, and they went to the hospital where she was being nursed. And a few hours after he left, she died.
Your computer's not connecting to the internet.
And then the final journey was when he decided to move to Adhisthana. So Adhisthana became his home for the last 5 years. And he's told several of us recently that the last year has been one of the happiest of his life. So Bante viewed Adhisthana, this place here, maybe not his barn, but anyway, this place, he viewed it as a place of lineage and blessings. Although maybe even this barn will be a lineage of blessings for us. He knew it would be where he would live his final years. He knew it would be where he would be buried. It is also where his libraries, his archives, and his Buddhist objects are all housed here. It is also a place where residential teams would work together, maintaining the vision he had for communication and friendship as an alternative to the individualistic and alienated society that he witnessed around him. And I think the last 10 days has really been credit to this community, well, to all of us that have been involved in setting this up. Adhisthana is also one of the places in the world where his particular presentation of the Buddha Dharma will be kept alive within a flourishing community. Buddhist teachers from outside Sri Ratna have sometimes remarked on Sangharakshita's far-sightedness in succession planning, and Adhisthana is a significant part in that succession planning. He wanted his worldwide community of Dharma practitioners to have a place that they could turn towards, a place of heart, of lineage, and of blessings. From my regular contact with Bante, I knew how much he served that vision in his final years. He served it in a way that he gave of himself to the situation, and especially through his contact with the many, many visitors that he saw while he lived here. Another aspect of his legacy is the Complete Works Project, the publication of all his writings, his talks and his seminars. It's an ambitious project, 27 very large volumes of text. And Well, that project needs our support as a way of the blessings or the lineage of Bhante to continue. So please support that in whatever way you can. Vinny Davy, one of Sangharakshita's main editors for the last 30 years, has actually created a book for this particular day, amazingly. And it's gathered from a lot of material by Sangharakshita. It's called 108 Ways of Looking at Death. So please maybe buy one of those when you're walking around. So finally, a few practical points. Switch off all mobile phones. I'll put them on flight mode, yeah? Has anybody else not done that yet? Yeah, just checking. We need as much bandwidth as we can get to live broadcast this event right now. We don't have a lot to start with, so whatever support you can give us would be greatly appreciated. Don't take photographs, we've got official photographers. The ceremony here. Right, stand up. The ceremony here will last between 1.5 to 2 hours. So you just feel free to move if you need to move. Go and get yourself a cup of tea and come back if that would work for you. And at the end of the burial, there'll be refreshments served somewhere over there. Okay, I'll now hand over to Paran. Thank you. So, I also welcome everybody here. So as Sadhnandi said, we've had an extraordinary 10 days here since we heard of the death of our teacher, Bhante Urgyen Sangharakshita. It's quite difficult to believe that those 10 days have gone by, and yet they've been used very beautifully. Not only here at Adhisthana, but around the world, our community has just come together, meditated, chanted mantras, sent their metta, their love, their best wishes to Bhante and to all of our community. So here today we have a gathering of people, all of whom, or many of whom, had different relationships with Bhante. For many of us, he was our teacher, he was a friend, he was family. People have known him for longer, for shorter amounts of time. There are people here who have known Bhante Sangharakshita for around 50 years. That's longer than quite a few of you have even been here. I don't mean here. Some people in this room and some watching around the world, some participating around the world, will never even have met Bhante in the flesh. I know someone here told me she'd met him once for 15 minutes. But it didn't really matter because our lives were touched, directly or indirectly. And Bhante Urgyen Sangharakshita's life touched the lives of hundreds of thousands of people around the world. Many of those people will be joining us today, many here, many in our centres, many individuals around the world will be with us and participating. So people knew Bhante Sangharakshita in many ways, some through his writings, which were mentioned, his talks, his lectures, perhaps most of all, for most of us, through the movement and the community and the order that he founded. So we're here today, as Sadhnandi told us, in Adhisthana. The word Adhisthana was chosen by Bhante to be the name of this place. I'm going to read you a little bit of the definition of that word. From its literal meaning of a site, a residence or position, the word Adhisthana is then applied to the power pertaining to such a position. It can therefore mean the power which belongs to divine form, and in this sense comes near to the conception of grace.
in that it may be transmitted by a spiritual teacher to his disciples, it may also be translated as blessings. So a very appropriate and apt name chosen by Bhante. His blessings are here, they're here in his presence, they're here in the work that's done, here and around the world. Around the world, that was very close to Bhante Sangharakshita's heart. The fact that we're an international movement was crucial to our movement, our community, our order. And we're about to have the witness the 7 traditional offerings being made here in front of Bhante's coffin, Bhante's body. And they're going to be made, that will reflect the international nature of our community, because 6 of those offerings will be made by a representative or a person here from each of the 6 geographical areas of our order and movement. So there'll be someone from Australasia, from India, from continental Europe, from here in the UK and Ireland, from North America, and from Latin America. So all those areas will be represented. We're witnessing them do that on behalf of our entire community. And the 7th offering will be offered by Lucy Lingwood, who is Bhante Sangharakshita's great niece. And I'm very pleased she could be with us today. So in a minute, we're going to, Paramachitta is going to begin the Shakyamuni mantra, which we can join in. And while that mantra is being chanted, those 7 people will just come up and make their offering there. After which, oh sorry, I've forgotten something.
There's always something.
So we'll just wind back. And we'll pretend I have just arrived. Because before anything else happens, we need to light the shrine. And salute the shrine. I've been doing quite well this week up to now. So I'm going to ask, first of all, Sadaloka, who is chair of our International College of Public Preceptors, to come forward and light the candles on our main shrine. So Sadaloka.
part in the ceremony.
This doesn't happen when we do this in India. And friends. So I'll now ask Vidya Ruchi, who's a Dharmacharya who has just come back from a visit to India, to come and put the garland on the photograph of Dr. Ambedkar. I'll now ask two Indian Dharmacharinis, Abhaya Nivita and Tarapradaya, to come forward and take a garland which will be placed onto the coffin, onto Bhante's coffin. And Abhaya Nivita and Tarapradaya were actually the last people who visited Bhante. They were his last visitors. So we will now all salute the shrine. We'll do that in call and response. Please feel free to join or listen.
Namo Tathagata Rama. Good morning.
will have a programme, so I won't go through what exactly is going to be happening. But I do want to say that everything happening today in the ceremony are things that were either chosen by or very important to Bhante. The mantras that we'll be chanting for the day are the five mantras that Bhante Sangharakshita asked us to chant from the time of his death, and they have been chanted continuously around the world. Those five mantras, five Buddha Bodhisattva figures, very, very important to Bhante Sangharakshita. The speakers are people who knew Bhante well and who were well known by him. We're doing the Metta Bhavana, short practice of loving kindness. We'll do a sevenfold puja, both of which are practices which are part of our common corpus of practices spoken and done throughout the world. And afterwards, when we're over at the burial, we will hear the Dhammapala Gatha, part of the Dhammapada, which was also a text very close to the heart of Bhante. The music was chosen by him, both the music that we heard when we entered and music that we'll hear later. So now I'm going to ask Paramartha to come up. He's going to share a reading with us and say a few words.
Namo Guru Urgyen Sangharakshita. Over the last few months, I've had the great privilege to be able to read to Bhante Urgyen Sangharakshita in the later part of the evenings. He wanted to go through a new translation of 100,000 songs by the great Tibetan yogi Narayana. And at the end of each reading, Bhante would sit for a while in silence, with his eyes closed, sometimes with his fingertips lightly touching, and that characteristic gesture of his, in what always felt to me like a deeply absorbed, even meditative state. In fact, on Bhante's final night in the annex, when I was helping him to get ready for bed, he suddenly turned to me, and I must admit he surprised me. He's wont to do that. By saying, "Well, you do remember the connection I had with Milarepa." And whether I looked a bit confused or sounded confused, he quickly added, "I've written about this in my memoirs." Of course. He was referring to the first volume of his memoirs that we know of the Rainbow Road. I'm ashamed to say that at the time I couldn't recall the exact details of that particular passage. So as you can imagine, before bed, I reread it, probably been about three times I've read it, and realised that actually it recorded Bhante's very first encounter with the life of Milarepa and the 100,000 Songs at the age of 21. When he'd been posted to Singapore during the war. In his memoirs, he singles out one particular song that obviously made a very deep impression. He talks about, and I quote, being especially moved by the song in which Milarepa, the Tibetan poet saint, hails his broken pot as his guru, because it has taught him the law of impermanence. Reading the life of Milarepa, Bhante, in another very moving passage, then goes on to say, and I quote, "My hair stood on end and tears came into my eyes. If I had any doubts about the nature of my vocation, they were now dispelled. And from that time onwards, I lived only for the day when I would be free to follow to the end the path that seemed had been in reality mine from the beginning." The following day, as we were waiting for the ambulance, the day he was taken to hospital, the day before he died, he again asked me to read from him, for him, the 100,000 psalms. Of course, we didn't have time to finish. So I would like to dedicate this song of realization, the song of transience with eight similes, from Tibet's great yogi to our own precious teacher, Urgyen Sangharakshita, who in many ways has given us so much. The song of transience and eight similes. Faithful disciples here assemble, ask yourselves, have I practiced Dharma with great earnestness? Has the deepest faith arisen in my heart? He who wants to practice Dharma and gain non-regressive faith should listen to this explanation of the mundane truths and ponder well their meaning. Listen to these parables and metaphors. A painting in gold, flowers of turquoise blue, floods in the vale above, rice in the vale below, abundance of silk, a jewel of value, the crescent moon, and a precious sun. These are the eight similes. The gold painting fades when it is completed. This shows the illusory nature of all beings. This proves the transient nature of all things. Think, then you will practice the Dharma. The lovely flowers of turquoise blue are destroyed in time by frost. This shows the illusory nature of all beings. This proves the transient nature of all things. Think, then you will practice the Dharma. The flood sweeps strongly down the vale above, soon becoming weak and tame in the plains below. This shows the illusory nature of all beings. This proves the transient nature of all things. Think, then you will practice the Dharma. Rice grows in the vale below. Soon with a sickle it is reaped. This shows the illusory nature of all beings. This proves the transient nature of all things. Think, then you will practice the Dharma. Elegant silken cloth, soon with a knife is cut. This shows the illusory nature of all beings. This proves the transient nature of all things. Think, then you will practice the Dharma. This precious jewel that you cherish will soon belong to others. This shows the illusory nature of all beings. This proves the transient nature of all things. Think, then you will practice Dharma. The pale moonbeams soon will fade and vanish. This shows the illusory nature of all beings. This proves the transient nature of all things. Think, and you will practice Dharma. A precious son is born. Soon he is lost and gone. This shows the illusory nature of all beings. This proves the transient nature of all things. Think, then you will practice Dharma. These are the eight similes I sing. I hope you will remember and practice them. Affairs and business will drag on forever. So lay them down and practice now the Dharma. If you think tomorrow is the time to practice, suddenly you find that life has slipped away. Who can tell when death will come? Ever think of this. Devote yourselves to Dharma practice.
So the temperature has gone down a little bit. So we can warm ourselves up with metta, loving kindness. But for some of you, that might not be enough, because you might simply be cold. And we really did mean it when we said at the beginning, and as what we informed before you came, if you want to get up and have a cup of tea, that's really, really all right. If you want, you can tap somebody on the shoulder who's standing at the back and just say where you are sitting. So we really mean that. Please don't freeze. Nobody wants that. So, this is a period of metta, loving kindness, towards Bhante, Urgyen Sangharakshita, and the Triratna Sangha, our beloved Triratna Sangha, and beyond our Sangha out into the whole world. And in the first part of our metta, loving kindness practice, we have an opportunity to call to mind our friend and teacher, Bhante, Urgyen Sangharakshita, to feel our love for him, to feel our appreciation for him, and our gratitude to Bhante. And I think, I'm sure, that calling Bhante to mind in this way, he can be very present to us today, and this will always be possible, night and day. Meditating on Bhante's qualities of kindness and wisdom, our faith and confidence in the Dharma will grow stronger and stronger. So, in a moment, for a few minutes, we will call Bhante to mind. And after those few minutes, I will ring a bell. And then, let us call to mind our Triratna brothers and sisters here at Adhisthana and around the world, hopefully able to see us right now and to participate with us right now. And certainly, even if they are not seeing us online, there are definitely many, many thousands are keeping us and Bhante in their minds and hearts right at this minute, all over our Tibetan world. So let us together establish the wish to be connected with each other in metta and in harmony, in one worldwide sangha, brought together by our precious teacher. Then I will ring a bell for a third short stage. Short but heartfelt metta for all humanity. Let us cultivate the wish that the blessings of the three jewels fall on all, for the lessening of suffering in the world, and that the Triratna community can make a significant contribution to this, so that the legacy of Urgyen Sangharakshita's teaching shines on for many, many generations to come. Thank you. So in a moment I'm going to invite Subhuti to make the first of three addresses to us. Subhuti first met Bhante in 1969. So he has been a friend and disciple of Urgyen Sangharakshita for 49 years. He was one of the first to whom Bante handed on responsibility for ordinations. And he was appointed by Bante as the first chair of the College of Public Preceptors. For many years he has divided his time between India and the West. I invite Sabuti to address this man.
Brothers and sisters, Namo Buddhaya, Jai Bhim,
Jai Bhim,
Jai Urgyen. To meet Bante since his death has become Urgyen, fully. But I'm sure, like many of you, Bante has had a huge impact. He's had a major influence on my life. Mahamati told you that I first met Bante 49 years ago. Actually, I saw him the first time 50 years ago, almost to the day. I saw him just walking along past Hampstead Heath. I had no idea who he was, but the image of his mindful, self-possessed presence is indelibly imprinted on my mind. I can see it right now. And it was only later that I realized the person I was learning meditation from was the one I'd seen so much earlier, somewhat earlier. I did see him in Hyde Park at a Rolling Stones concert, but he denies it. since Bante's died, I've sort of realized more fully the impact that he's had on me. I feel he's in every breath I take. I feel he's in the flow of my blood. I feel he's in the beat of my heart. And his presence is at the back of my mind, sometimes right at the front of my mind, all the time. It always has been. But since there's no physical locus for his presence, I've realized, in a way, who he really is. Free from the specificity of a body, he's become something vast and limitless. That presence has not always been a comfortable one, I have to say. Certainly for me, and perhaps for some others too. Bante is not a comfortable and convenient teacher, as we all know. He's left us with some wonderful paradoxes and dilemmas. Perhaps gurus should never be comfortable and convenient, but he certainly wasn't. Uncompromising, unconventional, and sometimes outrageous. And I wouldn't have it any other way. He's, of course, a human being with a particular character. And that character, that human personality, has led to things that I certainly find difficult to come to terms with. But nevertheless, always, 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 and even more now, I've experienced the shining light of the Dhamma through him, penetrating deeply inside me, and which I will never, ever be losing. It can't lose it. It's so much part of me. And I'm sure that in various ways this is very much the same for many of you, that Bante will have affected your life, turned it upside down, inside out, and you'll never be the same after that encounter, I hope. The Bante himself is very aware of his own limitations. He famously said that he was not really the right person to start a new Buddhist movement. He had so many limitations. In a way, any being has to occupy space and time. And whatever's in space and time has to be specific. It can't be everything. And if it's one thing, it can't be another. So, by definition, any teacher has to be something very definite and therefore not something else, and cannot encompass the whole field. And this is the sort of paradox of the Bodhisattva. And I believe Bhante is a Bodhisattva. I'm convinced Bhante is a Bodhisattva. On what level, what stage, I have no idea. That's beyond me, and I don't really care. It's really only the Buddha in whom there's a perfect consonance between transcendental realization and spatio-temporal manifestation. That's what the Bodhisattva does, lifetime by lifetime by lifetime. The Bodhisattva prepares him or herself by practicing the paramitas so that they develop a perfect body of wisdom and punya. So that when they manifest in their own Buddha field, they are perfect. But up until that point, the Bodhisattva is always, as I say, specific, doesn't cover the whole field, maybe has flaws, maybe has blind spots or whatever. But always the Bodhisattva is in touch with something transcendent, and it's that transcendent dimension that drives the Bodhisattva. So yes, I believe that though Bhante himself considered himself to be limited in certain ways as a founder, maybe just by virtue of being, as he says, interested in the humanities rather than science, maybe in other ways. Nonetheless, he was deeply imbued with the spirit of the Dhamma, which shone through him upon so many thousands, hundreds of thousands of people. In India, you see, sometimes I've certainly myself addressed crowds of 30,000, and Bhante himself addressed so many hundreds of thousands of people, all of whom caught that shining light of, a glimmer of that shining light of the Dhamma coming from him. And so many people in the future will catch that, even though they never meet the man. His influence will live on. So that's the paradox of the Bodhisattva, and we must keep focusing on what the Bodhisattva is attempting to body forth, and that Bhante so skillfully actually has bodied forth. Look at us. We are the sons and daughters of Urgyen Sangharakshita. I keep thinking I'm in India. Yes, we're Bhante's sons and daughters, born of his mouth, as the Buddha says, of himself. And we are trying to continue the Bodhisattva activity that Bhante began so wonderfully. But Bhante says that he's not the ideal person to start a new Buddhist movement. The new Buddhist movement had to be started in 1967. And it's worth us just reflecting why that is the case. It's difficult to sort of realize it now because the world has changed so much in the last 50 years. It's a very, very different world in so many ways. But in 1967, when Bhante felt himself constrained to start a new Buddhist movement, the scene for Buddhism was not very promising. He started in London, in the Hampstead Buddhist Vihara, working at Buddhist Society, and by his own account, and something of my own experience, it was not a very dynamic or attractive setup. Buddhism was still primarily an upper middle class preserve. It was still predominantly intellectual in its appeal, and sort of profile was conventional, you might say. Bhante was, for instance, told by one of the leaders, that he should consider himself the Buddhist vicar of Hampstead. If anything, if Bhante is not anything, it's not a vicar. Nothing against vicars, of course. But Bhante isn't one. It wasn't very promising. Lot of sectarianism, even though there were a few dozen Buddhists that were already polarizing into sects. A wonderful faculty that we have as human beings to polarize. He'd been working in India and very closely identified with the movement of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar and considered himself to be taking that movement onto his own shoulders at Babasaheb's death. But he found it more and more difficult to work because the movement was essentially getting more and more bogged down in politics, both politics as its idea, as its perspective, so to speak, but also internal politics. For instance, he found that when he was in Pune, he couldn't get the different Buddhist groups to agree to arrange his program. So he relied on the Pune District Women's Association, which was run by later Dhammacharini Dhammalochana, whose daughter is here today. Where is she? Ashmita. Bhante felt increasingly cramped by the environment of Buddhism in India, even though he was deeply inspired and felt a strong connection with the generality of the new Buddhists who wanted to help, increasingly difficult for him to do so. So, not very promising there either. The situation for Buddhism generally was not very bright. Buddhism has been, in the 20th century, in its worst period of decline ever. We only have to think that the Chinese invaded and really pretty thoroughly tried to stamp out Buddhism in Tibet from 1956 or so onwards. Of course, they didn't succeed, but they certainly broke it as an essential part of the local culture, of the broader culture. In many other countries, Buddhism has been in retreat from communism, and more recently from the universal and most effective religion the world has ever known, consumerism. Materialism has really pushed back the Buddhism. And Buddhism has not responded yet, as a whole, all that well. There are very bright spots, and there are certain groups and individuals who very much kept the Dharma alive. But as a whole, Buddhism has been in decline. Bhante saw this very, very clearly, and saw that what was needed was a completely new start. For one thing, Bhante was very aware of the broad spread of Buddhism. And he, from the start, I think at the age of 18, he gave a talk at the Buddhist Society called The Unity of Buddhism. So for him, Buddhism was a whole. You couldn't align yourself with any one particular school. You had to identify with the whole of Buddhism and draw on whatever was valuable in that in order to try to re-express the Dhamma in the modern situation. And that's what he set out to do. And for all his saying he wasn't the ideal person, he was certainly good enough. And here we are to prove it. He was certainly good enough. Even though he's left us a few very nice little conundrums and difficulties which keep us on our toes. He's been a good enough guru. With sometimes absolutely impeccable instinct. Nothing, for instance, demonstrates that instinct as his choice of when to die. He might have chosen better weather, but in every other way, he's chosen the absolutely perfect moment. When it almost passes, but we deeply mourn him, we're not worried. We're not bothered. We know that Bhante's done his work. We've taken into us the task that he's given us. We're well accustomed to taking the responsibility. 18 years since he handed on his responsibilities as head of the order. He timed impeccably. And he died just before the public preceptors were meeting, so that we could Well, I think they had a brief discussion. I'm no longer I'm a retired public priest. They had a brief discussion of what after Bante. So they all said, why are we talking about this? We just carry on. It's all going on. Bante's timing is impeccable. And it's important that we, at this point in having a very pure experience of Bante, because we're freed from his spatio-temporal existence, to sort of dwell a little bit upon what it is that is left, something transcendent, something that can't be caught in the net of words. He himself says that he does not consider that he founded the order and the movement. It was founded through him by what he talked about at some points as a suprapersonal force. At another point he said that there was a vast overshadowing consciousness that founded the order through him. And it's that vast overshadowing consciousness that I believe he has now, as it were, become identified with. He's fully part of that and fully continues. He will continue to function in the future in whatever way we do not know. I had an extraordinary conversation with him about 6 years ago when we were still in Birmingham, Majumaloka. It took my breath away, like sometimes happens with Bante. I went to see him and he said he wanted to die. He was ready to die. He said he found this life disgusting, is the word he used. I think we must be careful how we understand that. I understand it as Nibbida or Nirveda, for those of you who are predominantly knowledgeable. This sort of sense of not wanting to be attached to the world. So he said he felt this sort of disgust with the world. He wanted peace. He wanted a rest. He looked forward to a rest when he died. Oh, Bante, you've got it now. And may you deeply enjoy it. He wanted to die so that he could rest from his labours. And it's extraordinary that he actually kept going. And I think he kept going because he wanted this place to be established so that something stood there as a focus for the future. And it was a tremendous strain for him to move here. When you're 80, 88, to move is very difficult. Most old people die when they have to move. But he took it. He did it because it needed doing. And he said, yes, I find this life disgusting. I don't really want to continue it. And he said, but I do believe in rebirth. There is rebirth. I believe in it. And he said that, and there is the Bodhisattva vow. So I'm sure that I will be reborn. I, of course, asked him where and when, because he would have blamed me if I had. But he wasn't going to be drawn on that one. Very sensibly. I think he thinks he's quite capable of sorting things out for himself without our help. I think Bante will be back. We may not know. We may not know that he's here. But that spirit that carried him along through this life, into this life, that founded this order, will continue, is continuing, and we can continue in contact with it. He himself was deeply connected to that spirit, and he's completely identified with it now, and we simply need to think of him, as Mahamati suggested, and we will be in contact with that essential spirit that now permeates the whole order and the whole movement, and that will flow out more and more fully into the world.
Thank you very much, Smriti. Okay, I'd like to now ask Dharmadina, Dharmacharini Adhigarika Dharmadina, to come up and share some memories of Bante. So Dharmadina was ordained on Bante's birthday in 1973. She was a very young woman then. She's going to share some stories of her time with Bante.
extraordinary exposition of the Dharma. And I was also fortunate to be at many of his teachings live, and many of his lecture series. One of my favourite series that I was present at is The Creative Symbols of the Tantric Path to Enlightenment. And I was so excited by the promise of that material. I was really keen on Tibetan Buddhism. This was quite an early lecture in the 1970s. So it took place in quite a small venue, and everybody was sitting on the floor, and I sat right at the front. But the power of Bhante's exposition of that material, which he was very in touch with, his energy, his faith, his conviction, his clarity, that energy coming out, I just could not keep my eyes open. I just fell asleep into that kind of semi-stupor that usually happens sometimes. And each week I would move further back into the room. 8-week series. By week 8 I had my back against the wall and I still fell asleep. So just expresses the power of Bhante when he was in full flow of the Dharma. When the Dharma was flowing through him, he was definitely a force to be reckoned with. I had to listen to the lectures later on tape to find out what they were about. There's many things I can say about my relationship with Bhante. It's a relationship I appreciate very, very much. But I'll just leave you with a memory of my last meeting with him. So it was here, it was last October, and I was here on a green Tara retreat. And that's the practice plan that he gave me when I was ordained in 1973. So we had quite a lively conversation leading up to it, actually over a running lunch. And eventually I said, I must get back to the retreat. And I think left it safely by and left the room. I think I was mindful of the fact that I might not see him again, even though he was very well. So I went back into the room and said to him, Bhante, I just want to say to you how grateful I am, how I appreciate the fact that you gave me the green Tara practice. And he just put his hands together like this, sort of bowed, very humble, very devoted, and said, and do you know who we received it from? As though there was a joint reception of this practice. And we said in unison, Chetal Sanjay Dorje, which was the teacher who'd given Bhante that practice. So I was just left with this image of him. I left the room, very moved, left with this image of him, just, you know, his hands bowed, so humble, so devotional, so reverential to Chetal Sanjay Dorje and to that practice. So this is a man who's had an enormous impact on my life, an enormous impact on many, many, many people's lives. But that kind of humility, that devotion, is what stayed with me. So that's an image that I will hold in my heart for the rest of my life. So thank you, Urgyen Sangharakshita, for giving me the gift of the Dharma.
So thank you so much, Damodina. Beautiful memories. Damodina is also one of our public preceptors, and I'm going to invite another public preceptor, this time one from India, to come and share some thoughts and memories. Before I do that, can I tell those of you who need to know that the live feed is back on in the Shrine Room? The screen is back on.
Which seat?
I'm going to ask Dharmachari and Mogisiddhi to come up and join us now. So Mogisiddhi, as a very young man, was involved in youth organisations dedicated to the work of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. And then when he met Sri Ratna, he knew that he had met a community in which he could practice. He was ordained in the early 1990s and has been, for the last 7 years, also a member of the College of Public Preceptors.
Dear brothers and sisters, I really feel very fortunate and privileged to be here along with my four public preceptor friends from India. I'm very, very happy to see so many Indian brothers and sisters who could come to this event. Actually, it is not easy to come to England for many Indian brothers and sisters, but still they could manage. It shows me how strong feeling they got for Bhante. And since we arrived here at Adhisthana, every day we were updating what is happening here. Right now, I believe that my many, many brothers and sisters in India, they are looking at this function, and they were very much keen that they attend this, even if they couldn't come to England at Adhisthana. Before coming to this, actually, we had in our mind that we will meet Bhante, we will see Bhante. And suddenly this news came that Bhante is no more. But really, as I said, we are really fortunate we still could come here and could see Bhante. What we call in India, darshan, that is really very important. We could at least see Bhante, could take his darshan. And every day we were telling our brothers and sisters back in India what we are doing here. And people would ask us, have you met Bhante? And we could see how deeply they were moved, how strong gratitude they got. I would tell just a little story about myself, as Parmi said. We were involved with youth organization, and many inspired youth, very strong faith in Dr. Ambedkar, and particularly his vision about Buddhism, that Buddhism can help us to grow as human beings. Buddhism can help us to change the world. And even Dr. Ambedkar said that propagating the Dhamma, propagating Buddhism is true service to mankind. And we were fully devoted for this. But still, though we knew that this is a noble path we want to tread on, but really don't know how to practice it. We had very lofty ideas Dr. Ambedkar had given us. And as Subodhi said, in those days, very few people had that strong inspiration for Buddhism. But we, very idealistic young people, we really wanted to live up to it. We want to really actualize what Dr. Ambedkar's vision to have new society based on liberty, equality and fraternity. But he said that these principles, these values, he had taken from his master, the Buddha. And we were a little bit struggling a bit, because all the people were talking about these values as being social or political values. But as Dr. Ambedkar said, he has taken these values from his master, the Buddha. So it must be something much more than that, much more deeper. But we didn't know. But we were fortunate enough to come in contact with this Sangha, with Bhante. And very first time when I heard about Bhante, when I heard about Sangha, I first time heard Bhante's name. So I was a little bit curious because I didn't know much about him. So I met many, many prominent leaders in Nagpur, those who were scholars, very upright, Ambedkarite Buddhist. And I went to them and inquired about Bhante Urgyen Sangharakshita. And they were amazed. I mentioned his name and they told me number of stories, because he was present at the time when Dr. Ambedkar passed away. And he was the only person who could really console people, who could really give people confidence, though your great leader is not there, but you don't have to worry. Buddha Dhamma Sangha will guide you. It will show you a path. So I heard many, many stories from number of people. But one particular person I remember, I went to him and I always used to go to him to talk about Buddhism, talk about meditation. And I went to him and he said that, okay, what do you want to talk today? I said, I want to know about Bhante Sangharakshita. And he was just sort of saying, felt very happy. He said, why did you want to know this? I said, I just came in contact with this Sangha, so I didn't know much about him. And he said, he's my teacher. And I was really amazed to see that I didn't know that before. And then many people I met, they said that Bhante Sangharakshita is my teacher. And suddenly he went inside, he went to his library and brought one letter and he showed me that letter. And that was the letter which Bhante had sent to Dr. Ambedkar at the time of mass conversion. And it was written so beautifully. It was original letter he was having with him, because he was the one of the main organizers of that mass conversion program. And that gave me really confidence that Bhante has got that connection with Dr. Ambedkar and mass conversion movement in India. And then I began to read books on Buddhism by Bhante Sangharakshita. One particular book I remember, that was Ambedkar and Buddhism. And I think that was the only book I could see written exclusively on this subject, Dr. Ambedkar and Buddhism. There were many books, many things about Dr. Ambedkar, but nobody talked about Baba Sahib's vision about Buddhism. And that was really amazing. That really inspired me quite a lot and gave so much confidence that yes, we are on the right path and we need really Buddhism to change ourselves and to change the world. And when I read that book, it was so fascinating reading Bhante's meeting with Dr. Ambedkar. But particularly his last visit was really very moving. Bhante put that in a very nicely, I couldn't put it in that way, but I remember how he put that, his last visit. Dr. Ambedkar was very desperate. He was worrying what would happen to these people, because just they became Buddhist, they just embraced Buddhism. But Dr. Ambedkar was really worrying what would happen, because he was very, very ill. He didn't know how long he is going to be there. So he was in a way sort of explaining Bhante what could be done, what is really needed to be done, and so much he was telling what he's thinking about. And Bhante explained that in the end he was so tired, he couldn't speak much, but he was just uttering, so much is to be done, so much is to be done. And I now believe it is Bhante who done quite a lot for us. Actually, I can't imagine without the Bhante, without the Sangha, what could have happened to India's revival of Buddhism. Because he was the only teacher who could really show us path. We knew this is the path. We knew that this is what we really wanted to do, because Dr. Ambedkar had inspired us, but we do not know how to treat this noble path. How to practice Buddhism. It is actually Bhante who has shown us this path. So we are immensely grateful and having very strong gratitude for Bhante. Bhante coined very important words, I think, in India. Because as Sukadev said, mainly most of the leaders were very much engaged with political and social activities. Very less attention was given to Dr. Ambedkar's Dhamma work. But Bhante coined very important word, I believe, and that is Dhamma revolution. And reading Bhante's that talk, Dr. Ambedkar's Dhamma revolution, was really very inspiring. And he delivered so many talks, and I think that Bhante's talk, Dr. Ambedkar's vision about Buddhism, has given us very strong faith in Buddhism and very strong confidence that we can practice Buddhism. When you go to India, I am having contact with lots of people. I meet many, many people in villages and in towns and in slums even. If you go to small house in slum, Patme, you will be surprised to see their shrine. You will see Bhante's picture there. Very strong devotion for Bhante. And if you go to rich people, because there are many Ambedkarites, well-educated, having very good jobs, very rich, having big mansions, very big houses, and you go to their house and see their shrine, you will see Bhante's picture. Such a strong gratitude, such a strong respect, it happened because Bhante, in a way, through Buddhism, has given us new life. We always talk that Buddhism changed our life, but for us, Buddhism just doesn't change our life, it gives us new life. And many people could say that how they are benefited because of Bhante. And that is something Bhante did for us. Actually, at this moment, many, many people remembering him, expressing gratitude. And I really feel very fortunate that I am here right now. And my friends asked me, among Siddhi, whenever you will go to see Bhante, because we were telling every day that we are seeing Bhante, we are seeing Bhante. So please take us with you. And my brothers and sisters, if you are listening now, I would like to tell you, I am taking all of you with me right now, at this moment. And Bhante is in our heart, and he will remain in our heart. There are a number of people who never met Bhante. But they got very strong respect for Bhante, strong gratitude. Very common people, and lots of well-educated, some scholars, some Buddhist scholars, they got the same respect for Bhante. Before coming to this event, I was talking with one scholar in Nagpur who is very prominent, very renowned. And we met in a function, and he was inquiring about Bhante, Bhante's health, and in new literature. I told that now we got big project, we are producing all Bhante's literature in book form. And then he said that Bhante is wonderful, and his words really wonderful, I like those words. He said, Bhante communicate Dhamma in a very simple way, yet very deep. It touches our heart. Because very common people, they say that we learn from Bhante, and even scholar, they feel that we learn from Bhante. And I believe, I have confidence that coming generation will always remember Bhante. They will be always grateful, and he is in our heart and will remain in our heart. Thank you.
Many years ago was compiled by Bhante from Shanti Devi's Bodhicharya Avatara. Through this puja, through this practice of this puja, we open ourselves up to the blessings and influence of the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas. We dedicate ourselves to the Bodhisattva ideal, and we cultivate the conditions for the arising of Bodhicitta. Subhuti had mentioned the suprapersonal force. This is another way of talking about Bodhicitta. So I just want to preface our performance of this puja by reading a few of Bhante's own words about Bodhicitta. So this is Bhante speaking to us today. Bodhicitta literally means the thought of or will to enlightenment. But the main point to grasp is that it is not someone's individual will in the narrow sense. You do, of course, have to start off with an individual will, making an individual effort. But the bodhicitta is something which, as it were, matters. We will be invoking the qualities also of Urgyen Sangharakshita. The sevenfold puja. With Mandarbha, blue lotus, and jasmine.
With Mandarbha, blue lotus, and jasmine.
with all flowers pleasing and fragrant.
With all flowers pleasing and fragrant.
And with garlands skillfully woven.
And with garlands skillfully woven.
I pay honour to the princes of the sages.
I pay honour to the princes of the sages.
So worthy of veneration.
So worthy of veneration.
I envelop them in clouds of incense.
I envelop them in clouds of incense.
Sweet and penetrating.
Sweet and penetrating.
I make them offerings of food, hard and soft.
I make them offerings of food, hard and soft.
And pleasing kinds of liquids to drink.
And pleasing kinds of liquids to drink.
I offer them lamps encrusted with jewels.
I offer them lamps encrusted with jewels.
Festooned with golden lotus.
Festooned with golden lotus.
On the paving, sprinkled with perfume.
On the paving, sprinkled with perfume.
I scatter handfuls of beautiful flowers.
I scatter handfuls of beautiful flowers.
Oh, my.
salutation. As many atoms as there are.
As many atoms as there are.
In the 1,000,000,000 worlds.
In the 1,000,000,000 worlds.
So many times I make reverent salutation.
So many times I make reverent salutation.
To all the Buddhas of the three eras.
To all the Buddhas of the three eras.
To the Sadharma.
To the Sadharma.
And to the excellent community.
And to the excellent community.
I pay homage to all the shrines.
I pay homage to all the shrines.
And places in which the Bodhisattvas have been.
And places in which the Bodhisattvas have been.
I make profound obeisance to the teachers.
I make profound obeisance to the teachers.
And those to whom respectful salutation is due.
And those to whom respectful salutation is due.
God for refuge. This very day.
This very day.
I go for my refuge.
I go for my refuge.
To the powerful protectors.
To the powerful protectors.
Whose purpose is to guard the universe.
Whose purpose is to guard the universe.
The mighty conquerors who overcome suffering everywhere.
The mighty conquerors who overcome suffering everywhere.
Wholeheartedly also I take my refuge.
Wholeheartedly also I take my refuge.
In the Dharma they have ascertained.
In the Dharma they have ascertained.
Which is the abode of security against the rounds of rebirth.
Which is the abode of security against the rounds of rebirth.
Likewise in the host of Bodhisattvas.
Likewise in the host of Bodhisattvas.
I take my refuge.
I take my refuge.
Namo tassa.
Namo tassa.
Bhagavato arahato.
Bhagavato arahato.
Sammā sambuddhassa.
Sammā sambuddhassa.
Namo tassa.
Namo tassa.
Bhagavato arahato.
Bhagavato.
Sikhapadam
Sikhapadam
Samadhyami. purify my body.
I purify my body.
With open-handed generosity.
With open-handed generosity.
I purify my body.
I purify my body.
With stillness.
With stillness.
Simplicity.
Simplicity.
And contentment.
And contentment.
I purify my body.
I purify my body.
With truthful communication.
With truthful communication.
I purify my speech.
I purify my speech.
With mindfulness clear and radiant.
With mindfulness clear and radiant.
I purify my mind.
I purify my mind.
Confession of thoughts. The evil that I have heaped up.
The evil that I have heaped up.
Through my ignorance and foolishness.
Through my ignorance and foolishness.
Evil in the world of everyday experience.
Evil in the world of everyday experience.
As well as evil in understanding and intelligence.
As well as evil in understanding and intelligence.
All that I acknowledge to the protectors.
All that I acknowledge to the protectors.
Standing before them.
Standing before them.
With hands raised in reverence.
With hands raised in reverence.
And terrified of suffering.
And terrified of suffering.
I pay salutations again and again.
I pay salutations again and again.
May the leaders receive this kindly.
May the leaders receive this kindly.
Just as it is with its many faults.
Just as it is with its many faults.
What is not good, O protectors?
What is not good, O protectors?
I shall not do again.
I shall not do again.
Rejoicing in merit. I rejoice with delight.
I rejoice with delight.
In the good done by all beings.
In the good done by all beings.
Through which they obtain rest.
Through which they obtain rest.
With the end of suffering.
With the end of suffering.
May those who have suffered be happy.
May those who have suffered be happy.
I rejoice in the release of beings.
I rejoice in the release of beings.
From the sufferings of the realms of existence.
From the sufferings of the realms of existence.
I rejoice in the nature of the Bodhisattva.
I rejoice in the nature of the Bodhisattva.
And the Buddha.
And the Buddha.
Who are protectors.
Who are protectors.
I rejoice in the arising of the will to enlightenment.
I rejoice in the arising of the will to enlightenment.
And the teaching.
And the teaching.
Those oceans that bring happiness to all beings.
Those oceans that bring happiness to all beings.
And are the abode of welfare of all beings.
And are the abode of welfare of all beings.
Entreaty and supplication. Saluting them with folded hands.
Saluting them with folded hands.
I entreat the Buddhas in all the quarters.
I entreat the Buddhas in all the quarters.
May they make shine the lamp of the Dharma.
May they make shine the lamp of the Dharma.
For those wandering in the suffering of delusion.
For those wandering in the suffering of delusion.
With hands folded in reverence.
With hands folded in reverence.
I implore the conquerors desiring to enter Nirvana.
I implore the conquerors desiring to enter Nirvana.
May they remain here for endless ages.
May they remain here for endless ages.
So that life in this world does not grow dark.
So that life in this world does not grow dark.
Om Aum Vajra Guru Padma Siddhi. Om Aum Vajra Guru Padma Siddhi Om.
So may I become
that
which maintains all beings.
That which maintains all beings.
Situated throughout space.
Situated throughout space.
So long as all have not attained.
So long as all have not attained.
To peace.
To peace.
So we come to the end of the ceremony that, as it takes place here in the barn. We're going to be moving on now to the burial, which will take place in the burial site through in the field. I'll say the practicalities in a moment. So Bhante's burial marks a very important transitional point for our movement. In a way, it's the end of an era. It's also the beginning of a new era. And it's a continuity and a continuation of everything that's come before. In a practical sense, Bhante isn't leaving us. He'll be buried here in our own land, here in our own place of blessings. And therefore his blessings will live on. In his absence, we'll also have his presence. We'll have his physical presence in the burial. We'll also have in our hearts, as others have said, Bhante living on. His presence will stay with us. His blessings, the blessings of Adhisthana, are the blessings of Bodhicitta. So our task, in a way, is to keep that alive in our community, in our hearts, and on into the world. So I'm going to explain the practicalities, and then we'll hear some music, another piece chosen by Bhante. When that music ends, we'll have the Green Tara Mantra. As the Green Tara Mantra begins, the six pallbearers will come forward, collect the coffin. Then they'll move the coffin, they'll come round and they'll start to make their way out towards the burial site. So obviously we'll ask people to make sure that that space is clear. Then those of us on the platform and the people from the College of Public Preceptors will follow and begin the procession. Others who are seated in these seats here, our Buddhist friends, the family, will also take part in that procession. So there are ushers around to help us to keep this moving. Also, those of you in wheelchairs or less abled might like to start to make your way as well so that you can get across to the burial site if that's where you're going. If you'd like to watch the burial, the live feed will continue in the shrine room. Then others will the ushers will help you to fall into place, and we'll make our way not only through the main exit there, but so I'll just carry on. So we'll make our way, some will make their way directly through. There are other ways to get round to the site. We've no idea how long it will take us all to get there. There's quite a lot of us. There are some chairs around as well if you need a little seat coming on over, or once we're assembled. Once we're all assembled, we'll have a reading read by Padmaraja, a poem of Bhante's called The Six Elements Speak. So he'll make his way to the microphone, which is set up there, and read that poem for us there. After the poem, we'll have the actual burial, which will be accompanied by the Amitabha mantra. After the burial, there'll be some offerings. First of all, after the burial, there will be the Dhammapala Gatha led by Chandrabodhi. And then we have the Shakyamuni once again. Shakyamuni mantra once again. During the Shakyamuni mantra, some offerings will be made by Sadaloka, Amritdeep, Ratnadani and Paramabandhu from the College of Public Preceptors. Then our International Order Conveners, Arajaya Lokeshwara, and Sadnandi as Chair of Adhisthana. So they'll go up towards where the grave is, and the offerings will be petals, flower petals, which will be strewn into the grave. Once they've come back down from that, we'll... Sorry, I know what's happening. That will happen with the Shakyamuni mantra, and when that dies away, that will actually be the end of the ceremony. And those of us in the inner circle, which are those that are leaving behind the coffin, public preceptors, guests that have been here on their reserved seats, we'll be in the inner circle around the gravesite. We'll just start to circumambulate and we'll leave, and then others can come up and also strew petals if they would like to. I know some people have brought offerings. Please feel free to leave them on the gravesite. It would be obvious where you can do that. Or if you would like to come up as we leave and leave them on the shrine here. So we're going to start to make our way. We're going to say our final farewells. Our final farewells to the physical Sangharakshita. But of course we will carry him with us. And Adhisthana has many meanings. Some have already been explained, but there's one that I particularly want to evoke at the moment. According to the Monier Williams Sanskrit Dictionary, Adhisthana can also mean the standing place of a warrior. You were a warrior, Bhante. A lion's roar and a warrior for the Dharma. So we'll take that with us. And I think you'll find this reflected in a piece of music that Bhante has chosen for us today. A warrior-like piece of music. So we'll listen to that music, and as soon as that music ends, we'll start the Green Tara Mantra, and we'll start to take Bhante on his final journey to his resting place here at Adhisthana.
Thank you. Om Sai. Thank you. Exists in you as bone, muscle, and flesh. But now I must go, leaving you light. Now we must part. Goodbye. I am water. I am ocean, lake, rivers, and streams. The rain that falls from clouds. And the dew on the petals of flowers. I am that which exists in you as blood, urine, sweat, saliva, and tears. And now I must go, leaving you dry. Now we must part. Goodbye. I am fire. I come from the sun. Travelling through space to sleep in wood, flint and steel. I am that which exists in you as bodily heat, the warmth of an embrace. But now I must go, leaving you cold. Now we must part. Goodbye. I am air. I am wind, breeze and hurricane. I am that which exists in you as the breath in your nostrils, in your lungs, the breath that gently comes, that gently goes. But now I must go for the last time, leaving you empty. Now we must part. Goodbye. I am space. I contain all, from a grain of dust to a galaxy. I am that which exists in you as the space limited by the earth, water, fire, and air that make up your physical being. But now they have all gone, and I must go too, leaving you unlimited. Now we must part. Goodbye. I am consciousness, indefinable and indescribable. I am that which exists in you as sight, hearing, smell, taste, touch, and thought. And now I must go from the space no longer limited by your physical being, leaving nothing of you. There is no one from whom to part, so no goodbye. Earth dissolves into water, water dissolves into air. Air dissolves into space. Space dissolves into consciousness. Consciousness dissolves into home.
So we'll conclude the cycle of mantras by chanting just for a minute or two, a couple of minutes, the Amitabha mantra. And the Amitabha mantra, the closing of the day, the setting of the sun, very appropriate mantra to chant at this point. Om Amideva Hri. Om Amideva Hri.
Yeah. sati sarai nati me
to begin the Shakyamuni mantra once again, during which those of you making offerings on behalf of our international community, our international workers' fellows, plus Sadhanandi from Adhisthana, to go up and place your petals into the grave. The petals, I believe, are on some chairs over there. And after they've come back down from up there, the steps will be removed. We'll begin to circumambulate while still chanting the mantra, and we begin to leave so that others can come and place their offerings here when the space gets prepared.
Muni.
Thank you. Amen. Mahamuni Shakya.